If you would like to learn more about any of the topics discussed on this webinar, or if you require advice on any other business matter, please do get in touch with the AKEBB. We are here to guide, help, and support you on a confidential one-to-one basis. We could also assign you a business mentor in your sector or put you in touch with professional advisors should that be required. Get in touch by emailing akepb@iiuk.org or by contacting a member of the AKEPB whose details can be found in the institutional directory.
Richard, let me bring you in. Leaving aside the legal implications for a moment and focusing on the commercial considerations, let me play devil's advocate. Assume I'm a hotelier. How is a CVA administration or liquidation relevant to me? What if I simply do nothing and see how things go?
Thank you, Aleem. Well, let's start with a company voluntary arrangement to start off with a CVA. The CVA is obviously the most powerful and flexible tool that you've got for any well-managed business. If you've got a hotel that's been running successfully for a number of years, then there's no reason why you ought not to consider a CVA to start off with. It leaves you in control of the business, which at the end of the day, you're the hotelier running the business. We're just an insolvency practitioner running an insolvency process to provide you some degree of protection and some degree of structure. But you're the best people to actually run the business itself. It's likely to mean that if you can get into a CVA, if it's well structured, it means the business and the company will survive. It does, though, need a lot of planning and a lot of thought and a lot of behind the scenes arrangement, and that takes a lot longer than most people would realize. I think everybody, all insolvency practitioners, will agree that the earlier you take advice, the earlier you seek help, the easier things are for the insolvency practitioner and, of course, the business. There's a couple of other things with the CVA which are useful. You can use it to do more or less whatever you want in terms of restructuring the business. As long as you can get the required percentage of creditors, which is 75% of unsecured creditors, to actually approve whatever you do, that's 75% of those who bother to vote, not 75% of all of them, then realistically, you're only limited by what you can actually put in writing and creditors can understand. But clearly, what you've got to do is you've got to have a credible business plan and you've got to have a credible exit for it. Otherwise, it's just not going to work. That's the bare bones of it. Obviously, in terms of things like redundancy pay and things like that, you can actually, by using a CVA, you can actually shelter the business from the cost of those things. You can actually, in certain circumstances, shelter the repayment of loans. But obviously, you have to bring on board secured creditors. You have to listen to what your creditors say. You have to talk to those who are going to have a large say in the business going forward. And the thing to do is at the right time, talk to them in advance, explain to them what you're going to do, explain what the plan is, give them the confidence that a CVA gives to people that the business is actually going to survive. Because if you've got confidence that you can make this business survive, then that's going to feed through to the creditors. And at the end of the day, you need them on board. You probably also need to restructure the business to a degree because, let's be realistic, there's going to be a lot of redundancies. There's going to be a lot of changes in cost structures that has to happen as a result of this, particularly for hoteliers, retailers as well, all sorts of businesses like this. But that's the reality of what it is. There's obviously a couple of benefits as well from a legal standpoint, from the director's point of view. They remain in control of the business. And if it's done properly, a CVA can provide, to a degree, an effective shield against, shall we say, past misdemeanors, which you do have to disclose in the proposal. So you have to tell everybody exactly what's going on. But nobody runs a business perfectly. Mistakes happen. As long as they're disclosed and everybody is aware of them, then you just move on with things. With an administration, realistically, it's likely to be your resort if you can't get into a CVA. There, you're more reliant upon the administrator being in tune with you as to the outcome that's likely to happen with the company. I mean, realistically, the business is likely to be sold in one form or another, and that's likely to be an option, particularly in the hotel industry. The administration, though, is only a temporary procedure. You do have to exit an administration. You do have to come out either via a company voluntary arrangement, which is quite reasonable exit route. It's more often than not after the business is sold in administration, you then end up in a liquidation, or even sometimes the company actually gets dissolved. So you're not going to choose an administration if you've got the prospect to do a liquidation, but you do get a statutory moratorium up front. Now, there are various things being brought in about moratoriums, and there is indeed already a moratorium that is available in conjunction with the CVA, but it's very, very rarely used because effectively it gives the insolvency practitioner personal liability during the moratorium period.
Richard, sorry, let me just stop you there. So going back to my example of me being a hotelier, let's assume I've come to some sort of agreement with my lender on a capital holiday. Maybe they've actually given me a little bit more credit to help with my liquidity. Staff currently on furlough, and I may need to manage my costs better. And that gives me a bit of a runway until occupancy hopefully picks up. Do I really need to consider this now? Isn't administration, CVAs, liquidations something you consider when things are going really wrong?
I don't think so. I think people underestimate how long it takes to actually put together a credible plan. Test it all. Make sure it all works. The very worst you can do by speaking to an insolvency practitioner about any of the insolvency procedures is actually to work out what the difficulties will be, how long it's going to take you, because at the end of the day, you have to produce a credible business plan. You need to see that. And whilst at the moment, there is a very large amount of guesswork that needs to go into, for example, occupancy rates, when business will return, at least you're making a best stab guess at it. And you can do an upper version, a midway version, and a lower version. And then you can structure your business on that basis. And if you've got some credible business plans like that, which obviously you have because your secured lender has given you some kind of holiday, and if they've given you some kind of capital holiday like that, typically banks tend to think you're in the better part of their business book, then the more you plan these things, the better the likely outcome. Nobody is going to be immune from an insolvency procedure in the current climate. It is going to happen to an awful lot of businesses, unfortunately. And the more you can do to avoid a business insolvency, the better. And you do that by planning thought and talking to people. And obviously, any insolvency procedure is a risk. You want to avoid it at all possible costs if you can. And you can only do that with planning. But as a hotelier, you've obviously got the assets behind you, normally, to be able to indicate that there's some kind of business there worth saving.
Yeah, I mean, with regards to CVAs, there's been a lot of coverage in the press recently that large retailers such as Clarks, Wagamama's, and Pret A Manger are exploring using CVAs as a vehicle to reduce their rents and close down loss-making stores. I understand, for example, Travelodge has been successful in their CVA and have recently reduced rents by circa 40% this tax year. Ian, let me bring you in here. Can you tell us when it might be better to consider an administration over a CVA?
We've all heard great benefits of the CVA, and there's no question that when a CVA works, it can work very well. There are often times when a CVA either won't work or maybe is not suitable. So I'm not going to say here that a CVA is always the best solution. A CVA, after all, is often over 3 or 5 year period, which is a bit of a noose around the business's neck. An administration can be a very quick process and can leave you with a new company, a new business, free of debt, which can then carry on into the future. Now, to give you an example, you could enter into a CVA, which may, if you get HMRC on board, and often a tricky creditor to get approval, if you've had a bad history with them, they may not approve it, and often they are a creditor of at least 25% of the creditors, so you would need them on board to get a CVA approved. But say, for instance, the CVA is unlikely to be approved because of the profile, or you don't want your cash flow affected by paying for 5 years arrears of debt into your CVA, rather than having a free rein to go off into the sunset with a new company debt-free. If you wanted, you could do something called a prepackaged administration. Now, the way an administration works is that the administrator has to sell to the highest bidder. So if you go down a prepackaged administration, that means is that everything is organized with the purchaser, everything is valued beforehand, so this is out of the business goes into administration and the assets are sold immediately by the administrator, quite likely to a new co that is connected, if not owned, by the same owners as the previous business or run by the same directors as the previous business in administration. And as long as this is done correctly with a sensible insolvency practitioner, it's often the best result for creditors and certainly would be a good result for the directors. So in terms of, you know, running a hotel, for example, you would probably need to refinance the hotel in NewCo, but the old funders of the hotel in OldCo will probably be quite happy to fund it in NewCo rather than have to face a situation with a close down and no business there to continue with, because their asset, the hotel, would be a lot worse when it's not trading than if it is trading. So an administration is a very sensible process and can be a preferred route than a CVA. In administration, what happens is parts of the business can be sold and parts of the business can be left behind. So if there are unprofitable stores, quick note on personal guarantees, the same problem. If obviously you've guaranteed the landlord, then it wouldn't help. But if you haven't got guarantees, you can leave unprofitable stores, unprofitable hotels behind. You can move ahead with NewCo and just focus on the profitable elements of the business and leave the old elements, old assets behind that you don't want, and leave behind all the liabilities. And that's how you end up with a new company that's debt-free and only has the profitable assets in it. So you can see how suddenly that business can make a lot of profit. And whilst you're not preserving shareholder value of the old company that may have remained had you done a CVA, you will quickly end up in control of a new business that makes that can make a lot of profit free of debt. So I'm not saying that a CVA every time is the right solution, because administration can be a very attractive solution as well. And that's why it's really important at the outset, right at the beginning, when you understand there are some problems, to go and seek advice, see what your options are and plan, because it's not a matter of just clicking your fingers and you're in a CVA. And indeed, a CVA might not be the right thing to do. So, you know, you need to think about all your options, whether it's administration, CVA, or something completely different. But, you know, an insolvency practitioner, a lawyer, will be able to give that advice.
So let me ask this question to both you, Ian, and Richard as well. If you have capital, if a shareholder has capital in a business, can you extract that capital out of the business using an administration or a CVA?
Effectively, in a CVA, you actually preserve the shareholder capital. As Ian has pointed out, where you're in an administration, you're reliant upon buying the business back into a new entity. But with a CVA, you're protecting it within the same shell. And there are some obvious tax advantages from that if you're in the correct tax position. And there's likely to be some tax position because you're likely to have incurred losses, which you can continue to use. But you should never let the tax tail wag the dog. A CVA can be a long-term thing, but you can make it as long or as short as you like, depending upon the circumstances. And it depends upon it, precise on the circumstances, how long it lasts. Equally, if a CVA is progressing well, there's nothing to stop you changing the CVA sometime in the future to actually make it a more suitable exit in due course by perhaps a sale of the business in due course once you've got it stabilised. But of course, you'd need your creditor to consent for that. And at the end of the day, with an administration as well, what Ian is saying is you need your creditor consent. You are going to need to talk to the stakeholders, the primary creditors, the bankers, the large large creditors, and your landlords to actually come up with a credible plan. But you preserve shareholder value better in a CVA than an administration. But if that's not possible, as Ian's pointed out, administration is the next best alternative. Go for it.
I think, Alim, I think whilst the CVA preserves shareholder value, often the only perceived shareholder value is in the eyes of the shareholder. And, you know, I mean, it's insolvent at the time. It's got possibly a long way to go to get back to a solvent position. And you've got to set off the possibility of future benefits from keeping that shareholder value alive, or the profits that you could potentially earn from a new company from day one. So I think it's not a straightforward calculation, and I think it has to be seriously considered. I mean, there are differences in the stigma attached to administration. Some businesses will suffer. Normally, and my experience over nearly 30 years, is that actually newco businesses don't suffer very much from the stigma. It's nearly always a perception by the directors that going through that sort of process is going to affect their business. I think at the end of the day, if the newco business can provide the same level of service, the same level of quality, they will get over that hurdle. All the customer wants is to make sure they don't have this problem with supply, that they don't have, take a hotelier. I, as a punter, going and getting my, double-bedded room with a flat-screen TV, if I go back to the hotel once it's been through an administration and I get a double-bedded room with a flat-screen TV and the service and the quality is the same, what do I care? So I think, you don't need to go down always a CVA route. It's not always the answer. But I totally accept that a CVA is often a lighter touch process and is easier. It's a much easier sell for me as an insolvency practitioner to the directors, because the directors remain in control. And that's huge. That is a massive part of why a CVA is often a better solution. But I'm just saying it's not always. And that's why you get advice.
Yeah. I mean, let's think about risks and what can go wrong with some of these solutions. I open it to anyone on the floor. Really.
A lot can go wrong, Alim. There are a number of stakeholders. It's not a simple equation. And, we as insolvency practitioners, we like to think we get it right a lot of the time, but we do get it wrong. But we'll never know whether an alternative would have been even more wrong. So it's a difficult one. I don't know, Richard and Bouja, whether you've got comments on the risks. I mean, clearly there's commercial and business risk here.
There's a risk with any insolvency process. There's a risk with any business. It's all about mitigating those risks and maximising the profit. What you've got to do is to maximise your profit, obviously, at the lowest possible risk. And at the end of the day, advisors should advise and clients should decide upon the process which they think best suits it. They know the business best of all. We can give them the advice as to how they should go about it and how to mitigate their personal liability, which is a big thing in all this. Everybody is going to have to consider what effect it is going to have on their personal assets. You also have to consider the stakeholders, the major creditors. I mean, some things are just not possible because creditors will not buy certain processes. It's as simple as that. They will not buy into a process sometimes of administration, sometimes a CVA, or even sometimes a liquidation. But there's always light at the end of the tunnel if you've got a quality business. You just need to work out the best way of maximizing that outcome. And that's what an insolvency practitioner should do for you, and it makes it easier if you approach them early in the process. Leaving it late in the process means you have to have some form of protection, right? So you have to run for something like an administration or something like that.
Richard, what I would say is that, you know, if you do have creditors that are not on side, a CVA is probably always going to start as a no-no, because you know it's built on trust. It's going out to your creditors and saying, here's the position, being totally transparent. Will you accept this? It's the best option available to you, Mr. Creditor. And if they don't like you, they don't trust you, they're not going to agree to it.
Absolutely agree entirely. If you've got,
you're forcing that position. So you are actually sometimes in more control going down the administration route. It may not be quite as stomachable, because there are harder things to deal with as a director. But with administration, and you're doing a pre-pack, it will happen. You can be in complete control, and you're telling the creditors, this has happened, and there's very little they can do, as long as, you know, the process is performed correctly and at value. I mean, you can't sell a business that's worth hundreds of thousands of pounds in terms of its assets for a pound. It's got to be sold at the right value. But, you know, that's subject to scrutiny, and a good IP will make sure that they cover that off.
I agree with that entirely. You're more in control of the outcome the shorter the insolvency procedure. So from that point of view, an administration makes sense, but it doesn't mitigate the risks that are available to directors as a result of going down what is a hard insolvency procedure, whereas explaining things in the nicest possible way. But you're absolutely right, Ian. If you've got somebody like HMRC who, because of past history, have an absolute block on it, or you've got a landlord who says no, and you're renting just the sole hotel off him, then the answer is you're not going to be doing a CVA. You're going to have to go down the administration route and force it through, if you can, with something like a pre-pack sale or something like that.
Okay, Mbuja, let me bring you in here. We talked about risk to directors and personal liability risk. What can directors do? What are the practical steps that directors can take to minimise this risk?
I'll answer that in terms of what directors should be doing, but I'll also touch on a few other considerations that might apply for particular sectors and particular industries as well, because we've talked about key stakeholders and creditors, but quite often you'll have a regulator or some kind of licensing body as well that will quite often play a key role in what a business can do. I always say when I'm advising directors at this stage, so sort of pre-insolvency, trying to assess their situation, I always say that they need to think about what they're doing and break it up into four different segments. So first of all, assess. Secondly, review. Thirdly, document. And fourthly, ask. So assess is exactly, you know, what it says on the tin. Where are you now? Make sure that you've got your up-to-date financial information. Make sure that you've got your cash flow forecast. Make sure you know what the business looks like. So in the context of lifting lockdown restrictions, what is that going to mean for your business? What is that going to mean for capacity, for example? So assess where you are now. But in assessing where you are, also assess what potential implications different insolvency options could have on your business. So for example, if you run hotels and you've got premises licenses because you run a bar, for example, and the bar contributes quite a lot towards your income, any insolvency process is going to bring a termination of that premises license if it's held in the company's name. So unless you're able to assess the situation to recognize that, you may choose to go down an insolvency process not realizing that that's actually quite a large impact. Now, obviously, there are ways around it, and there are ways of transferring off-premises licenses and things like that, to allow you to continue selling alcohol if that's what the business model is based on, or a large part of the business model is based on. But it means recognizing the position and planning for it. Similarly, if you've got sort of regulators such as the CQC, the Care Quality Commission, might have, they obviously want notifications, but they also want assurances about financial provenance and what a care home or a dental practice, what they have in place, or if we're talking about social care or housing. There are regulators that you need to be aware of as well. So when you're assessing, look into that. Also, and I'm going to say this as a lawyer, obviously, when you're assessing, look at your legal contracts. If your business model is based on a franchise, for example, what are the termination events on that? Will your head office impose termination clauses, for example? And again, that's something which there's talk about provisions being introduced to protect businesses from that type of thing happening. But as the law stands at the moment, so not looking at prospective law, you could find quite onerous termination clauses, potentially in franchise agreements or in supplier contracts and things like that, all of which could have an impact on the running of your business going forward. So absolutely, first of all, assess where you are. Secondly, reviewing. Assessing is brilliant, but if you're not going to keep on monitoring it and going back to it to see if it still applies, the initial assessment is redundant very quickly. So keep on reviewing the situation, update it. As you know, if lockdown restrictions are going to keep on changing. Well, you've got sort of 2 meters at the moment in terms of social distancing, but 1 meter plus if that's okay. At some point in the future, that might diminish completely. Equally, you could have a second wave and a spike, which might mean that more onerous restrictions are brought back into place. How's that going to affect businesses going forward? So keep on monitoring your situation, update your cash flow projections, and keep on top of things. The third thing that I talked about was documenting. Again, this is a very lawyer thing to say, but if you can prove and evidence what you're doing, then it makes my job as a lawyer, when I'm protecting or defending directors from action, or it makes it so much easier to say, the directors thought about this and here's the evidence that they thought about this, as opposed to, we think we had a conversation about it at some point, it was in a car park, but we can't quite remember where it was. Mm-hmm. Particularly where you're talking about family businesses. And I appreciate that a lot of people listening may well be talking about family businesses, where it's absolutely natural to sit around a dinner table and talk about business and what's happening and what ideas might people might have to make things better, or what things they're concerned about. I've got to stress the importance of making notes and taking that on board, just because, you know, particularly in family businesses, it's really important to remember that the positives of a family business and why family businesses are so effective at running successfully. But that doesn't mean that you don't document things and run things in a way that you would if we were talking about external people involved in the business and decision making.
Can I just come in and just re-emphasize the point about this documentation? It's so much harder for me as an insolvency practitioner to chase a director where they've got notes, comments of meetings, thoughts, thought process, their discussion with their advisors. Even if they get it wrong, as long as they've gone through a robust process and documented it, they will be largely protected from the worst effects of any wrongdoing that may occur, right? Nobody's ever going to get it right. Ian's made the point, insolvency practitioners don't always get it right. Nobody's got the right to get it right. But if you don't document, as Ambuja has said, what you've done, right, when you did it and why you did it, that is a very good defence, even if you do get it wrong.
Can I mention, in the context of the bounce back loans, they're so easy to get. I mean, obviously, they're only up to £50,000, but you basically sign a document and you get given money. Now, I would say, as a director, you need to set out in a minute, or at least evidence it, to say how you expect to pay that back. Because if you don't, and eventually you're put into liquidation and that loan is still outstanding, I think that's a clear evidence of misfeasance, because no director should take out a loan and not think about whether they can repay it. And whilst we may all have, you know, these wrongful trading freezing restrictions going on at the moment to cover directors, that doesn't cover them from misfeasance. And as Ambuja said, you're in breach of your duty if you're not, one, checking that you can act in the best interest of creditors, and actually that you act in the best interest of the company. A company shouldn't be taking out a loan if it can't pay it back.
One of the points I'd make is you need to document as well why you're taking the loan out. Not just the fact that you can pay it back, you need to explain why you're doing that course of action. And even if you explain it and it goes wrong, you have a degree of protection.
It comes down to how reasonable your behaviour is. It's not reasonable to take action without thinking about it. If you thought about it, but the outcome wasn't what you expected, or the outcome hasn't turned out the way you would have wanted, at least you still thought about it. But if you've thought about it and not written it down, we can't prove it.
If you can evidence even a misguided thought process, that's better than not evidencing any thought process.
Yeah.
And sorry, Aleem, can I just say, the worst thing that you can possibly do, guys out there, if you're listening, is to do nothing. At least do something. At least talk to somebody and write down the fact that you've talked to somebody and actually decided to do nothing. That's better than actually doing nothing and keeping it all to yourself, internalizing it. Do something. Do it early. Write it down.
That brings me to my last point of the four, which is you've got to ask for help. You've got to seek professional advice. And whilst you're absolutely right in that directors of businesses know how their businesses run, insolvency professionals know how insolvency works. Accountants know how accounts work. There is professional advice out there. You're not expected as a director of a business to know the answer to absolutely everything. What you are expected to do is know when to ask for help. And that's why it's really important to seek guidance, to take professional advice that's available to you. Richard, Ian and I are used to dealing with these things on a day-to-day basis and have done for a number of years. And we've seen all sorts of business failures and business successes. Use our experience to help you make your decisions.
And there's a lot of free advice out there at the moment. I mean, I know I'm giving a lot of free advice. I mean, obviously, eventually, we may want a job out of it. We're not completely a charity. But, you know, this is the time to ask for advice, because insolvency practitioner firms like mine, we're giving a lot of free advice at the moment. We're on the phone talking to clients, emailing them afterwards, giving them some written advice, even though we're not being formally engaged or paid. Yeah, we're not putting our necks on the line. Of course we're not. We're not engaged. But, you know, it is advice, it is free advice. And if it leads you down a path to a strategy to deal with the future, and that you might have to pay for, that's the best bit of free advice you could ever have.
And any reputable insolvency practitioner will provide you with half an hour or an hour's worth of advice, or just listen to you talk for half an hour or an hour, right, free of charge. Because they need to do that to need to understand A, the problem, and B, whether they can help. If they can't help, they will say.
Okay, so final question to each of you. If you had to convey one key message to whoever's watching this video, what would that message be? Let's start with Ian, and if you can keep it quite short and crisp.
Yeah, well, I would hark on about taking advice earlier. I think the amount of calls I've had saying, I've got a few problems now. And then when you dig in after about 5 minutes, you realise they've got to pay the wages on Wednesday and they don't have the cash. HMRC are knocking on the door wanting to take all their assets out of the premises. It's a little bit late. I mean, what we want to have is advice early. Everyone knows at this stage that income levels are not going to return to 2019 for some time. That is clearly going to be a problem for hotels. It's going to be even more of a problem in the hospitality sector, where you have to be about 70% occupation, 70% levels just to break even. So that's not likely to happen for a while. So I think every business in that sector is going to have trouble, and they should be taking advice now. I can't see an excuse for one person in that business to think they're any different from anybody else. That's it. That's short enough, isn't it?
I'm going to keep it very simple and not reinvent the wheel and echo what Ian says. Take advice, take it early, document it, and follow it. It's very, very simple. It's not difficult. Take early advice and follow it.
Vijay?
And I'm going to stress again the documenting and record keeping. Every single business decision you make, particularly when a business is approaching financial distress, write down what you're doing, why you're doing it, and who you've spoken to about it. Write it down. Keep those records.
Well, that brings us to the end of today's webinar, which was truly fascinating. Ian, Richard, and Ambuja, on behalf of the Aga Khan Economic Planning Board, thank you so much once again for your time and invaluable input. Thank you, guys.
Not at all. Thank you.
Thank you.